using to a greater scale.
Tonight, TVI includes an interview with President Galtieri. He expresses firmness. But is there any shift in Argentinian opinion?
Militarmente preparada para responder.
Argentina is spiritually and militarily ready to answer.
This week, all eyes turned to the United Nations. A day or two ago, hopes again were high. Maybe the Argentinians would agree to negotiate without a guarantee of sovereignty. And now? Well, now nobody's quite certain. And tonight, in this specially extended edition of TVI, we try to chart where we are in the search for a solution. In London, the politicians, after today's debate in the House of Commons, what are their expectations? And they'll be reacting to our own exclusive interview with the leader of Argentina, President Galtieri. He gave the interview to reporter Julian Manyon at 2 a.m. Buenos Aires time this morning, after an extraordinary evening in which the TVI crew had been kidnapped, robbed, and abandoned by unknown assailants. But first, from New York, a film report by Peter Gill on this week's efforts by British diplomats to reach a negotiated settlement with the help of the United States at the United Nations.
An American plays the bagpipes to welcome shoppers to British Week in a Washington shopping arcade. The special relationship at work. Trade as much as sentiment reinforces the relationship. Everyone we spoke to in the shops that day was pro-British on the Falklands conflict. Most thought the British were doing a decent job in putting their case across to the American public.
I think they are. I really do. We've been in such a situation in our own country where with El Salvador, for instance, as Senator Goldwater was saying a couple weeks ago, you can't tell who's a good guy and who's a bad guy. And Americans are looking for somebody to put a white hat on and a black hat. And in this situation, it's a clear-cut thing where the British are the good guys.
On duty last weekend to open British Week, Her Britannic Majesty's ambassador to the United States, Sir Nicholas Henderson. Old England enjoys an instinctive appeal in America. And much of the sympathy we're currently enjoying is just as instinctive. Not once in his perambulations that morning did Sir Nicholas have to mention the crisis on his and many other people's minds. This was the non-controversial flag-waving of modern diplomacy. Sir Nicholas Henderson in Washington has been a leading player. The American peace effort collapsed a week ago. Now Sir Nicholas concentrates on maintaining a broad spectrum of support for the British position. Last Saturday morning, a live TV interview with Cable News Network. The British Embassy has lost count of the number of TV interviews that Sir Nicholas has done since the Falklands crisis started. Sometimes there have been two in a morning. At 7 a.m. on the live breakfast shows, having digested the overnight telegrams from London and the American newspapers. American official support for the British has not stopped interviewers looking for the weak spots in Britain's case. I asked the interviewer, Dan Shaw, senior correspondent of Cable News, how he viewed Sir Nicholas's performance.
You have here an extremely adroit, practiced professional who has done very well. He cannot do better than the British case appears to be in the American public. At the beginning, the British case looked very good, and there was overwhelming American support for that case. I suspect that there's been a slight turning of the tide from the time that the Bill Grano was sunk. In spite of everything that is said about warnings having been given, it is perceived as having been a willful act of punishing the Argentines in an area outside the declared zone of blockade. And from that time, there's been a certain weakening, I think, of support for Britain.
Can you identify any problems in presenting Britain's case to the public here?
The Americans have a great problem, a psychosis, about getting involved in another Vietnam. So they don't want to start down a path that could involve their forces, in fact, being engaged. Then I think there's a slight difficulty because some Americans are worried about a conflict, friction between one part of the American hemisphere and the other. They don't want to appear to be a north and south rivalry within the hemisphere. But the support for us, the support for our case, the understanding of it, judged by all the ways you do understand these things, press, television, correspondence, has been overwhelming and solid.
In a suburban estate in Virginia, a demonstration of just how pro-British the Americans can be. They call themselves American Friends of the Falklands, And last weekend, they were stuffing envelopes with yet more material on the British case. Much of it has been flown in from the Falkland Islands office in London. The group has already secularized Congress and the Washington Press Corps, and they say some are coming back for more. They've collected thousands of signatures condemning the Argentinians. Sunday morning in Washington. The British have bombed the Falklands airfields again. Argentina says there's an invasion. Sir Nicholas Henderson has already performed one task this morning, telephoning Secretary of State Haig, who's out of town, and telling him of London's latest outlook on the military and diplomatic front. At home in Washington, Bob Cheshire, chief US correspondent of the Observer newspaper. Had he noted any deficiencies in the way in which the British case is being presented?
No, I mean, there's clearly a slight problem with the colonialism, the feeling that this is a war out of its time, that perhaps we ought to have been able to solve it without launching an armada, and so on. And in a sense, Sir Nicholas represents the old-fashioned British colonial appearance.
You think this image actually helps? This is an image that actually the Americans respond to?
I think they do. They're used to the quick sell, to the PR man, to the spokesman in a rather flash suit and coming before the cameras well-groomed and so on. To see this slightly shabby, well, that's wrong. He's a dandy, but he's not, you know, that careful. His collars pop out from inside his jacket in the middle of an interview and so on. Yes, I think that is something the Americans like.
Sir Nicholas, what are the key functions of your embassy in a crisis like this?
Two main responsibilities. First of all, to negotiate with the US administration, the White House, the State Department, principally the Secretary of State Haig, and other departments, the Ministry of Defense included, about the whole, what our policies are, what the negotiation, the Americans' decision to support us and what that involves. And second, a whole realm of work dealing with the public opinion, the Congress and the media, to try to explain to them why we're engaged in this action and to what extent and why it's also a US interest. And that isn't something really one can take for granted or assume people automatically understand.
Do you think there are circumstances in which support for the British case could actually slip away here?
Yes, if it appeared that the British had lost sight of the principle in the race, I mean, like a boxer when hit on the nose, suddenly losing control of himself just because he's so angry. I mean, if he gets to that point, that the lion's tail has been tweaked and the lion responds too forcefully, I suspect it could disappear then.
Are there circumstances, do you feel, in which the British might lose this overwhelming support in the US?
No, I don't think so, but as I say, it's not something you can take for granted. It isn't something one can simply sit back. I think it's got to be worked at. But the Americans do respond both to reason and principle, and as long as we can get both of those across, I'm quite confident we can hold it.
The start of a make-or-break week of negotiations at the United Nations in New York. After a weekend of contacts, a pattern, almost a ritual, has been established in the United Nations mediation role. The Argentinians are represented by their deputy foreign minister, and the British by the head of our permanent mission at the United Nations, Sir Anthony Parsons. In the spring sunshine, Sir Anthony, on the left, accompanied by a first secretary, manages to walk the mile from his mission to the UN. It's the only fresh air and the only exercise that he'll get all day. Parsons has served twice at the UN in senior positions. Now, at the end of his tour as head of mission, he's built up unrivaled contacts, experience in the right place at the right time. Parsons' job is to relay London's negotiating stance on a South Atlantic ceasefire to the Secretary General, acting as go-between. Even on the British side, it's not been a static position. From these closed-door contacts, it's become clear that the British are no longer insisting on the paramountcy of the Falkland Islanders' wishes, no longer insisting even on the temporary restoration of British rule in the islands. For the new Secretary General, Perez de Cuellar from Peru, the Falklands crisis has proved a critical early test. Can he succeed where Secretary of State Hay and all his American muscle have failed? As a South American, his standing is high with the Argentinians. But he's also complimented by the British, Sir Anthony Parsons in particular, for his scrupulous fairness. None of that keeps the news hounds at bay. Each time Parsons emerges from the UN, he's submerged by the press.
The British want him to negotiate?
Of course the British want to negotiate. Okay. Yes, what a ridiculous question.
But what about the broader forum of the United Nations? Is the British message getting across there?
I think we're getting it across pretty strongly. Mine isn't an enormous delegation, but it's a very, very active one. And a lot of us have been here for some time, and we've worked together as a team for a long time. And we know how to keep in touch with all delegations simultaneously, as it were. We've been doing this consistently over the last 5 or 6 weeks since the crisis started. I think we've got our message across all right.
We started with this great success, Security Council Resolution 502, which was your own drafting, a British drafting. Has there been any waning in support for the British since then, as we've taken successive military actions against the Argentinians?
Fundamentally, I don't think so, no. I think that delegations to whom I've spoken still believe that 502 was right. It expressed the correct principles, and they still stand by that. Of course, in this place, there is a tremendous antipathy to the use of force by anybody. And there's tremendous anxiety building up about the growth of military action in the South Atlantic. I mean, people are getting very worried and genuinely concerned.
In a lifetime, in a career of diplomacy, how do these negotiations compare with others that you've been involved in by way of complexity of involvement?
I've been involved in Middle East negotiations now on and off for 35 years or so. Nothing could be more complex than that. But of course, this is a peculiar circumstance that we are negotiating at tremendous speed against the background of hostilities which have already broken out and the possibility that they could become much more serious. And we're also negotiating very much in the open of the United Nations with 1,000 press people around us, you know, the whole time. There is a special quality about this round.
Hello, ABC, good morning. It's BIS, British Information Services. We're having live at 10:15 question time with the Prime Minister out of Parliament. Would you like to have it? Okay, good.
Outside the UN, the British are fighting a more extensive battle to put their message across. And who more appropriate to represent Britain than Mrs. Thatcher herself?
The EEC has given us very staunch support. Beginning of this, the Falklands campaign, right from the beginning of it, gave us very strong...
Tuesday morning in New York, that's Tuesday afternoon in London, and Prime Minister's question time in the House of Commons is fed live into the offices of the British Information Services on Third Avenue. Through them, some 6,000 radio stations are reached throughout the United States.
But the meeting of the Organization of American States last month showed that many Latin American nations were shocked by Argentina's unprovoked aggression and fear the dangers for themselves.
The British are so far maintaining a vigorous assault, even on citadels of pro-Argentinian opinion. Patrick Nixon, Executive Director of British Information Services, provides a right of reply editorial to a local New Jersey TV station serving the Spanish-speaking community.
Nothing could be more disastrous for the stability of the world. Europe and Latin America are a part of the same tradition, Western, Christian, and free, and should always be joined in friendship. It is a tragedy that Argentina, by acting aggressively, has isolated herself from that friendship.
Juan Abraham is New York correspondent for Argentinian Channel 11 television.
What about American public opinion? Who's winning that battle, do you think?
I think that you have a very clear lead when this started, April 2. It was a very clear lead for the British American public, influenced by radio, television, and newspapers, where I would say fairly 80% behind the British.
What's happening now?
Now I think it's splitting, and it's splitting badly for the British and very good for the Argentinians.
Late Tuesday night, and Enrique Ross, the Argentinian negotiator, returns once more to the Secretary General's 38th floor offices. He is able to present yet further refinements on the Argentinian proposals for circumventing the vexed problem of sovereignty. He knows that the British will never accept direct negotiations that concede Argentinian sovereignty over the Falklands in advance. For direct word on the progress made by the Secretary General, the world relies on his official spokesman, François Giuliani.
The problem we have here is that we have very, very confidential talks. They are highly charged, basically emotionally, because every word counts, and these words are not just words. I mean, they have to do with national honor and history, and of course we can't upset the apple cart for the sake of information. So we have to be very, very careful about what we say, and we really describe technically what's happening, but the substance is almost nil.
Sir Anthony Parsons leaves the UN after presenting the Secretary General with the latest British responses. And in this phase of the Falklands crisis, at least, the view from the States is that Britain is being well served by her diplomats.
Peter Gill reporting on film earlier this evening on the selling and explaining of the British case in America. But for an up-to-date assessment of the growing anxiety about the fate of the latest UN peace moves, we rejoin him by satellite in New York with Sir Anthony Parsons.
I think we're now getting into the heart of a number of issues, and it's going to be very difficult for anybody outside the negotiations to determine whether there is progress or non-progress. We're getting to the heart of the issues, and this makes it even more difficult for anything to appear on the surface.
Yesterday seems to have been a day of no great progress. You've just come from yet another session with the Secretary General. How are things going today?
Well, I went back to the Secretary General today, and indeed when I saw him yesterday, and I went in great depth into a number of issues. Only time will tell whether these discussions between him and me, yesterday or today, will eventually represent progress.
I gather there's to be an informal meeting of the Security Council tomorrow afternoon, in which the Secretary General will be bringing Security Council members up to date. Does that represent some sort of cut-off point in the Secretary General's participation in these negotiations?
Oh, no. I think that there's been a very obvious and very understandable concern on the part of the members of the Security Council to be kept informed. And the Secretary General and myself have been regularly briefing the President of the Council. Tomorrow's informal consultations, I would expect that the Secretary General would deliver a very brief report without going into any detail. I shall certainly not expose any detail myself. I think that all the Council members want to be satisfied of at the moment is that active negotiations are continuing, and to have some feel of the Secretary General's idea of how it is going without any detail being exposed.
What are the stumbling blocks in your negotiations? Are we dealing with technicalities now, or are we still very much in the principles of this dispute?
No, I think we are dealing with a number of substantive issues. I really can't go into details. I'm sorry, I wish I could, but you must understand that I must be discreet about that. We're dealing with a whole range of very substantive problems, and we're going very deeply into each one at the moment.
How close are we to satisfying that British precondition that nothing must be prejudged in the later negotiations that one hopes will get underway between Argentina and ourselves, particularly the question of sovereignty, that must be left open?
Well, I hope that we are closer to that. That is, of course, an absolutely essential point for us. I'm sure this point has been made in the House of Commons today. I understand there's been a debate. This is an absolutely essential point from our point of view, and my present judgment is that here, at any rate, insofar as the Argentine delegation here has expressed views, that we are in slightly less unsatisfactory shape on that at the moment.
You're saying there's some movement to report on that?
It looks like it, but it would be difficult to be too definitive about that. We shall have to see when more of the points, more of the main elements in the agreement start to emerge. The thing will have to be a package.
As most of you will be aware, Julian Manyon's report this week has been compiled in extraordinary and distinctly unpleasant circumstances. Yesterday, he and two of his colleagues, cameraman Ted Adcock and sound recordist Trevor Hunter, were kidnapped in Buenos Aires and fortunately released later in the evening, having been robbed and stripped, but otherwise unharmed. Later still, a nocturnal encounter took place between them and Argentina's President Galtieri. From Buenos Aires this evening, this report from Julian Manyon.
The mood in Buenos Aires here is both unsettled and uncertain at this moment. The newspaper headlines are talking about fighting in the skies over the islands, but in fact what's really on people's minds is what is happening to the talks. Now, yesterday was not really the perfect day for us here to assess the progress the talks were making, or indeed public reaction to it, because we were kidnapped by a group of people in Ford Falcon cars who took us away and held us for 3 hours. But in fact, this strange and extremely uncomfortable incident provided a unique opportunity of finding out what the senior figures in the Argentine government now feel about this crisis with Britain. Because when we returned, we were taken immediately at the invitation of the Interior Minister to the Presidential Palace, where he presented us with his views of the situation and then introduced us to the President himself, Leopoldo Galtieri. And I was then able to take the opportunity of asking the President how he now views the war, the crisis with Britain, and the efforts to settle it. What chances are there now of a negotiated settlement, in your opinion, of this war?
Negociado a vuestro juicio y en este momento.
Mientras hay diálogo, mientras se hay canales de comunicación entre ambos gobiernos, siempre hay posibilidad de lograr una solución honorable para ambas partes.
While there is a possibility of communication, of interchange of opinion between both governments, there is always a possibility of an honorable solution for both parties.
La República Argentina tiene vocación. Tiene vocación de llegar a una solución no militar al problema.
The Argentine Republic has a vocation to reach a solution, even though it not be military.
Sin embargo, si la Gran Bretaña sigue usando con mayor intensidad sus medios militares,
if Great Britain, however, continues using to a greater scale its military power,
la Argentina está espiritualmente y militarmente preparada para responder.
Argentina is spiritually and militarily ready to answer.
Is Argentina prepared to drop the insistence on sovereignty in order to get peace?
La insistencia sobre la soberanía con tal de obtener la paz.
La soberanía argentina que la estamos reclamando desde 1833.
Argentine sovereignty, which we are claiming and asking for since 1833.
Siempre es y será objetivo del pueblo de la nación argentina.
Has, is, and will always be the objective of the Argentine people.
No vamos a renunciar a ese objetivo.
We will not give up this objective.
Podemos conversar para buscar ese objetivo en un plazo razonable.
We can have a talk to seek this objective within a reasonable time limit.
Pero no 149 años más.
But not 149 years more.
The normal definition of negotiations
normal de negociaciones, señor presidente,
is a situation in which two sides sit down,
ambas partes se sientan ante una mesa,
not knowing what the final result will necessarily
sin
be.
Saber cuál será la conclusión final desde un principio.
Are you prepared to hold those kind of talks with
preparado
Britain?
Para llevar a cabo ese tipo de discusiones?
Sí, señor.
Yes, sir.
Reconociendo la habilidad diplomática histórica de la Gran Bretaña, que la reconocemos porque es toda una historia.
Recognizing the British diplomatic ability, because we do so, because it's a historical ability.
También nosotros, que somos buenos alumnos,
we that are good pupils,
estamos en condiciones de sentarnos a la mesa diplomáticamente,
we can also sit at the table diplomatically,
para acordar los puntos de vista que buscando la paz,
to agree upon the viewpoints, diplomatic view, that in looking for peace,
nos lleven a lograr lo que desde 1833 está buscando la Argentina,
will enable us to find what since 1833 Argentina is seeking for.
So, sir, are you actually prepared to pull down the Argentine flag on the islands in order to get those negotiations started. Para que comiencen negociaciones, llegaría ese extremo.
No, señor.
No, sir. So that really is the sticking point.
O sea, este es el problema álgido.
Creo que se puede conversar, señor.
It can be talked upon.
How near are we to war?
No hay duda de que si Gran Bretaña ataca, nos va a obligar a responder con todos los medios.
No doubt, if Great Britain attacks, we shall have to answer with all the means at our disponibility.
Do you believe that Great Britain is about to attempt to retake the islands?
Gran Bretaña está por atacar, por reconquistar las Malvinas?
Creo que se está preparando para atacar.
I think it is getting ready to attack.
Es la decisión política del gobierno de Gran Bretaña de realizar o no el ataque en los próximos días.
It is the political decision of the government of Great Britain to carry out or not the attack in the forthcoming days.
President Galtieri talking to Julian Manyon in Buenos Aires at 2 o'clock this morning, the first interview he's given since the crisis began. So, are there any signs there that the junta is seriously prepared to make concessions in the cause of peace? And as we consider that, and before we go to Lou Gardner and the politicians to hear their opinion, one more Argentinian interview that Julian Manyon did this evening, this time with the foreign minister of the Argentine, Mr. Costa Mendes.
My feeling is that we are closer to peace than to war, and that the talks in the United Nations under the conduction of the Secretary General are on the move. Slowly, perhaps too slowly, but they're on the move. And for the time being, they have not been suspended. Talks have not been suspended, and talks continue. And if there are some minor and some big problems yet to be solved, I can say that in the last 3 days we have been, I could say this, that in we are today in a better position in our search for peace than we were 3 days ago.
Can you state clearly for us what exactly is the Argentine position on the crucial issue of sovereignty?
I have stated that very clearly so many times that I wouldn't like to remind you of what I have said. For Argentina, the goal of this negotiation is sovereignty. But this is not the precondition to begin negotiations.
You appear then really just to be offering Mrs. Thatcher an elegant way to climb down.
This is a question, a very well put question, and I think that I can answer yes.
What you're saying, though, is in a sense a challenge, surely, rather than a compromise.
Every negotiation is a compromise.
With me to discuss those two interviews now, I have Sir Anthony Kershaw, Chairman of the Commons Select Committee on Foreign Affairs, Stanley Clinton Davis, a Labour spokesman on foreign affairs, and Russell Johnston, who is the Liberal spokesman on foreign affairs. Sir Anthony, if I may start with you, what do you make of it all? The President, at least in tone, sounded conciliatory. Was there anything in the substance?
I didn't think there was, unfortunately. And I don't think that the foreign minister after him was made very much difference either. I also bear in mind that I understand another spokesman of the Argentinian government tonight said that the goal must lead inexorably to Argentinian sovereignty. If that is so, one does wonder to whom one can talk in the Argentine junta.
Do you feel they're not in charge? I mean, that's from our sounding seems to be the view in Whitehall, that perhaps we're not talking to the people in charge even.
Well, I think they're in charge, but I'm not quite sure who's in charge. If you ask Costa Mendes one thing, you will get an answer, and if you ask Galtieri something, you'll get another answer, and perhaps they'll come back tomorrow morning and give you different ones again. This has been one of the difficulties all along.
And yet our man at the United Nations, Sir Anthony Parsons, does seem to see some shift. He talks about a slightly less unsatisfactory state.
Well, I think that they've moved their condition from the front of the negotiations to the end of it. As you remember, in 1938, about Munich, when Winston said the dictator has consented to not to take all the victuals at once, but to have them served to him course by course.
Stanley Clinton Davis, I mean, they seem less dogmatic on sovereignty. Are they really flirting with concessions? Are they looking for something back? Or are they just lying and playing for time?
Well, the Foreign Secretary in the debate today said that there was some greater indication of a genuine Argentinian willingness to negotiate than had been the case before. And that must be based on some evidence, and that's encouraging. And then again, we did have a somewhat confused picture presented by the Foreign Minister of the Argentine and the President just a moment ago. They talk in one turn about an objective as far as sovereignty is concerned, and then on the other hand, when asked, the President says there's no intention of removing the flag. And then there are further qualifications.
If I may just pick you up on that. He said that. He said, no, senor. Yes. Then he said it can be discussed. I mean, they seem to contradict themselves within one sentence.
That's right. And that's the problem, I suspect, that the British diplomats who are engaged in this negotiation are having.
Russell Johnson, I was going to ask you about the hauling down of the flag, but do you see any sign there at all that they're moving? And that is it worth carrying on, talk, jaw?
Oh, yes, I think so. I think the reason why you're getting these faintly optimistic noises from Francis Pym, on the one hand, in the House, and from our diplomats in the United States, is they're trying to create some conditions of hope for a successful negotiation. But I'm afraid, the raw material is very depressing. I mean, Galtieri did not give anything in what he said, not anything at all. I mean, he made it quite clear that sovereignty was not negotiable. Then you had Costa Mendes coming on and saying that sovereignty was not a precondition, bearing out what my two colleagues have said a minute ago, that it's very difficult to put one's finger on it.
Not a precondition, if I understood it, in the form of words to start the negotiations, but a precondition about the goal of the negotiations.
Well, that's not an acceptable situation, I wouldn't have thought.
Sir Anthony, you wanted to come in.
I don't think we should get too hooked on the issue of sovereignty as far as we're concerned. We were, after all, discussing sovereignty before this affair blew up altogether. I think now, after we know what's happened and can assess the Argentine government more accurately, we oughtn't to agree to sole sovereignty for Argentina. But we are prepared, as I understand, to discuss some diminution of British sovereignty, some sharing of sovereignty with some other nations or the United Nations.
Do you speak for all the Conservative Party in that, sir?
I wouldn't think I speak for all the Conservative Party. I'm not actually...
I'm not trying to nail you down. I mean, I just wonder, isn't there not a strong body of opinion within the Conservative Party who really say, take the place back, put them in their places, put the British Union Jack back up? Isn't that where we started this thing? Aren't there still a lot of Conservatives who think that?
Yes, but they can't stop there. I mean, I don't think anybody seriously contends that we're going to put back the thing exactly as it was before and continue as before. That is obviously futile. What we intend to do, of course, is to get the Argentines to withdraw. That's the sticking point for our point of view, that they must do. But then sovereignty, I think we could discuss to dilute British sovereignty, but certainly not to hand it over to complete and sole Argentinian sovereignty. I think that really is the position of the government as I understand it.
So Stanley Clinton Davis, if they move, if they withdraw, can there not be some kind of words that get round this question, this precondition of sovereignty?
Oh, I think Francis Pym said weeks ago, and the Labour opposition leader said, Michael Foot said weeks ago, once the Argentinians are persuaded to withdraw, then all options are open. And this, I think, is a sensible point of view to take. What I do rejoice in is the role that the Secretary General of the United Nations is taking, because we did urge this on the government many weeks ago, that in default of the Hague negotiations succeeding, we should place great confidence in the Secretary General. Now,
less worse than many Conservatives feared, I think, the United Nations.
Yes, it's not so bad as some people thought. But we know we did start off with the United Nations. We went there in a gallop right at the beginning and got Resolution 502. Yeah. I don't think you can say we didn't use the United Nations. No. We used it very well, but to some purpose.
But there was a need, I think. Once the Hague negotiations began to flounder and eventually failed, it was very important that we made use of the Secretary General. That's why Dennis Healy went to New York. And I think it was the right thing to do. And I think Francis Pym should, in fact, have gone at that time.
Russell Johnson, can I put perhaps to all of you something that struck me about that interview? Here we're looking at a man who's led his country into the greatest crisis that it's probably had in this century. He's faced with the greatest armada to sail from any nation since the Second World War, at least. And yet he seemed totally calm, relaxed even. Is he just bluffing? Is it all sort of Latin show, or has he got some reason for confidence?
I don't think you can answer that question.
But it was an extraordinary performance, was it?
Certainly, it was a very relaxed performance. Particularly, it was 2 o'clock in the morning, I understand, that it took place. That's true. I don't know how you can answer that. I mean, the problem really is that we have to face is that while, as Sir Anthony Kershaw says, and indeed Stanley Clinton Davis rightly, that we can't make ultimate sovereignty a sticking point, and we didn't before. What I think I would prefer, the way I would prefer to put it, is that I believe in the principle of self-determination. I want to see the Falklanders having it. I also am prepared to face the fact, and the British government must face the islanders with the fact, that we may not be able to maintain what we would like to maintain.
And yet the Prime Minister came back to that very question in Question Time today, didn't she? She not only said there will not be a sellout, we're looking for a peaceful agreement, not a peaceful sellout. She also, if I recall it correctly, went on to say to once again talk about self-determination for the islanders. And yet that's not really on, is it, Sir Anthony?
Well, not self-determination against the background which they had before. Yeah. I think before asking the islanders...
Qualified self-determination.
Before you ask the islanders the question, you must set the scene and ask them what you're selling to them. I don't think we can sell them the status quo ante. They wouldn't want that. They'd be overwhelmed yet again, probably in 10 years' time. But we have to sell them a proper arrangement which makes them feel safe, safeguard their lives and their way of life. And that, I think, we can only do in some sort of diminution of control of the islands in accordance with the United Nations principles and so on.
You've all come from the House of Commons. My reading of the day's events and the listening to the speeches is that there's considerably less optimism even than there was yesterday. The sands are running out, are they not, Stanley Clinton Davis?
I didn't gain that impression. No, there is a good deal of restlessness on the Conservative benches. I mean, Francis Pym at one stage was subjected to a pretty vigorous attack from some of the blow them out of the water brigade.
And Ted Heath as well.
And Ted Heath too. I think there is a greater sense of realism than there was initially in the House of Commons. I think that the government has moved very substantially. After all, they have accepted the Peruvian plan. It was the Argentinians that rejected it. And that, the acceptance of the Peruvian plan, meant that the government was moving very considerably from its initial stance. And they've accept the withdrawal of the Argentinians in stages, if necessary, providing it's supervised. There's no longer an insistence on a return to the status quo ante. There's no longer an insistence on a return to British administration. There's a possibility of, as Anthony has just said, of some change in that situation. So there has been a very substantial move as far as the British are concerned. Unhappily, it's not yet been matched by the Argentinians.
But aren't we also getting near the point, I see the Evening Standard running a story from America tonight, where we either have to use this task force or withdraw it, and aren't we getting near the point where Mrs. Thatcher can, as you've just illustrated, legitimately say, I've explored every diplomatic avenue, it isn't working, we have to, if we're going to get anywhere, we have to escalate the force, here I stand, I can do no other. Aren't we very near that point, Sir Anthony?
Well, there must come a time when the talking's no good anymore. Mm. And if the Argentines show in the next 3 or 4 days that really they haven't shifted at all and they're just playing for some kind of delay, then of course what you say is true. I don't think myself that Parliament has shifted very much. I think that the left wing of the Labour Party has been really sunk without a trace. I think the broad mass of the opinion in Parliament, and I believe in the country is fairly satisfied with the way things have gone and the way things have been conducted.
We've talked about the Conservatives who fear a sellout. How do you judge that mood in the House, Russell Johnson? Is that a genuine fear, or can the government contain it? Are they free to do what they want, or are they in charge of what I suppose Stanley Clinton Davis would call the hard men?
Well, Sir Anthony is in probably a better position to answer that question than me. I would say that they are in charge. On the other hand, it is quite true, as Stanley said, that they have shifted their ground very, very considerably since the first debate on the 2nd of April.
You agree with that,
Very markedly.
I would come back to you. I just want to see if he agrees with that point.
Yes, I do. I think everybody's in favour of negotiation. It's becoming clearer what you're negotiating about. Right. It was difficult to formulate it right at the beginning, to say what the negotiations could be after this act of aggression. But now we've got down to the work, it looks better.
Russell Johnson,
but
please.
On the other hand, I think everybody on all sides of the House who broadly has supported what the government did in sending the task force as a backup to diplomatic activity is aware of what you said, the sands of time running out and what is going to happen in the next few days. John Knott, you will remember, very recently said that there existed the option between an assault, which we were all extremely alarmed about because of the possible loss of life, and a blockade. On the other hand, we keep being told that a blockade, in fact, is impractical in real terms because of the weather conditions. And, you know, we're not military men, but we're deeply worried about it.
If this round of talks finishes or seems to break down completely, is there anything left? Where do we go from there if we don't use the force?
I don't think there's any insistence upon using the force. Ted Heath said this today, that the government ought not to pay attention to its critics who say that the task force, having been sent, must never be sent back without being used. And I think that's right, and I think all three of us would probably agree on that point. The fact is that there is still room for possible negotiation.
But what do you do if it breaks down? What should the next move be?
The next move must, in fact, to consult our allies very carefully as to what we should do, because we have to take into account the opinion of our allies. They've supported us with sanctions. They've supported us in other ways. So we have to take that into account. And to move immediately following the breakdown of negotiations into a frontal assault on the Falkland Islands would, I think, be a cardinal error.
Sir Anthony, this government hasn't got a great record of taking the advice of Ted Heath. Will they go on talking if this lot breaks down, or will they have to inexorably to use force?
Well, Francis Pym said nothing preempted, nothing excluded. We've tried Al Haig, we've tried Peru, we've tried the United Nations. If that goes, the only person I can see we can negotiate with would be Argentina direct. And in their present mood, I don't see that succeeding.
Would the Conservative Party stand for direct negotiations?
I don't see why not. We stood for negotiations. It doesn't matter whom we negotiate with, provided we bring home the bacon.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said. I'm sorry.
Provided we bring home the bacon. Yeah. That's not a rude thing to say about Argentina.
Would that not be a fear, though, that there was a fear of then of a sellout?
I wouldn't have thought so, but I think we are bound to negotiate while negotiation is possible. But if it appears clear that Argentina will not, the consequences are clear.
I'm sorry. May I ask each of you in the last minute, we've had 6 weeks of this crisis. Is there optimism still in your hearts at this late hour, Russell Johnston?
There is hope, but there's quite a bit of pessimism, I'm afraid.
Stanley Clinton Davis?
I rather share that view, but I think as long as the talking is going on, that's fine.
Sir Anthony?
I'm not optimistic, no.
On that, I think, unhopeful and pessimistic note, I hand over to Dennis.
Thanks, Lou. Well, the political mood there in London tonight. Well, finally, as we all wait for further political or military developments, we turn to the news story in which our own colleagues found themselves directly involved. The abduction just outside Buenos Aires of three members of our TVI crew, their disappearance for 4 hours, and their release, which led to that interview with President Galtieri. For more details, we talked to Julian Manyon, but because the Argentinians will not allow us to satellite direct from Buenos Aires to London, Peter Gill spoke to him from New York.
Julian, how were you all treated during the hours of your abduction?
Well, for a start, I can only really speak for myself, because in the first instance of our kidnapping, we were all separated. I was seized, had a gun put to my head, thrust into one of these cars that are known here as Ford Falcons, and then forced to lie down in the space between the back seat and the front seats, with the gun still pressed to my temple, as the car sped off at high speed towards the outskirts of Buenos Aires. In the course of that, I had no opportunity even to speak to the people who were holding me. They just didn't want to know. I tried to speak to them in some halting Spanish that I've picked up here. Every time I opened my mouth, they slapped me in the face. They put a piece of cloth over my eyes so I couldn't see anything, and then ordered me beyond that to keep my eyes closed. And this journey went on, this first part of the journey went on for almost an hour, with the car cruising, heaven knows where, towards the outskirts of Buenos Aires.
Looking back on this ordeal of yours, who do you now believe your abductors were?
Well, what I would say can only be speculation. First of all, I can say that I have been assured in detail by both the Interior Minister and the President of this country that the abductors were not working for the government. And naturally, having been assured in such a way, I have to, in a sense, to accept their assurances. However, what I can say is that, in my opinion, they were, the people who took us were without question members of one of the branches of the security services of this country.
Do you now fear for your safety and the safety of other correspondents and your colleagues in Buenos Aires?
I would like to say that I didn't, but I'm afraid that I do, in the sense that that when you see, as I did this morning once again, a Ford Falcon with the same kind of three people cruising just ahead of us as we approach the Foreign Ministry to do an interview with the Foreign Minister Costa Mendes, which we've just recorded, those people, heaven knows who they were. They weren't the same people who picked us up, but they were plainly, judging by the radios and the radio aerials from their car, the same kind of people. These people seem to have an extraordinary license here. Not as much license as perhaps they had at some times in the past, but they still have a license. And that, if you like, is what is truly worrying. And really, I can only reflect on the last moments of what happened in this situation. We're in the middle of the countryside. My colleagues and I were forced to undress completely. We're shown that our captors had weapons in their hands, pistols and an automatic rifle, and were then asked to walk with our backs to them down a road in the middle of the countryside, away from their vehicles. Now, I'm afraid that that is, if you like, a worry that is not going to go away very easily, though we did make it to the end of the road.
Julian Manyon on a most unhappy incident, which fortunately ended happily enough with him and his colleagues unharmed. Some final points from the House, from Defence Secretary John Knott, who said a few minutes ago, we cannot allow the situation in the Falklands to continue. This will involve diplomatic and military action, and reminded the House that the sending of the task force had two objectives, to exert pressure on the Argentinians and to be in a position to end the occupation if necessary. So from TVI, on a night when the search for peace, though it still continues, grows ever more urgent, good night.